Merkel after several meetings she had with President Trump on his overseas trip. Let's go to our international correspondent, our senior international correspondent, Fred Plykton in London with more. Fred, you have spent an inordinate amount of time in Germany, in Berlin, covering Angela Merkel. What was your reaction when you heard her remarks?
Well, I think it's almost unprecedented, Poppy, and I think it certainly does show that Angela Merkel feels somewhat alienated by the Trump administration and really finds the Trump administration and President Trump very, very difficult to figure out. And that's why she made the statement where she's saying, we can't rely on others for our security in the future anymore. And that certainly is a striking statement coming from one of America's closest allies. Let's just listen in quickly to what Angela Merkel said exactly.
The times when we can completely count on others, they are over to a certain extent. I have experienced this in the last few days, and that is why I can only say that we Europeans must really take our fate into our own hands.
So you hear there Angela Merkel, she didn't mention President Trump by name, but she certainly seemed to reference some of the meetings that she had with the president over the past week or so in Europe, both in Brussels and in Italy as well at the G7 summit. Now her spokesman came out later and said, look, the chancellor did not want to say that she's giving up her alliance with the United States. To the contrary, this is Stefan Seibert, Angela Merkel's spokesman, saying, quote, those who have accompanied Chancellor Merkel journalistically for a long time know how important the German-American relationship are. They are a pillar of our foreign and security policy, and Germany will continue to work on strengthening those relationships. So certainly the Germans are saying they do want to continue this relationship with America. However, it does appear as though for the time being, at least with this new administration, they really aren't sure where they stand, Poppy.
Just to be clear, Fred, Angela Merkel is not someone who speaks off the cuff.
Yeah. No, she certainly isn't. And I do have some experience accompanying Angela Merkel for the past 17 years or so. And she's not someone who would just make a remark just like that. Now, we do have to mention she is right now in an election campaign, but she's firmly in the lead. And she is certainly someone who really thinks things through. She's always been known not for flamboyant statements, but certainly really for choosing her words very carefully. And that's really something that also in the German press, I can tell you, people are saying, look, this could have pretty big consequences for relations in the future.
Clearly knowing that this is the remark that would get all of the headlines. Fred Plykton, thank you. Joining us now, Christiane Amanpour, our chief international correspondent, Aaron David Miller, CNN Global Affairs analyst, and Lieutenant Colonel Rick Francona, our military analyst. Christiane, to you. Wow.
Well, listen, Poppy, it's absolutely correct. Angela Merkel did step forward and say this stuff over the weekend. But she also brought Britain into it as well. She basically was referring to both the United States and Britain. Why? Because Britain, which is the second most important heavy lifter when it comes to military might and all sorts of other things with NATO after the United States, is on the Brexit track. So they're very concerned that they can't count on Britain either. And then, of course, regarding the United States, you know, they ended the G7 summit in Sicily on an unprecedentedly divided note. They could not even come up with a, you know, with a joint statement, as they always do, because President Trump would not agree to the commitment to the Paris Climate Accords. So that all lent, you know, a bit of discombobulation to what should be a set piece summit meeting. So that's what happened. And she has been, you know, warning for some time. This is not the first time Angela Merkel has said that we Europeans need to take more of our destiny, more control for our destiny in our own hands. And I would just say one thing. Yes, she has laid down a marker. Yes, it's the beginning of a, you know, new look at how potentially the transatlantic alliance might go. But she did use two very important qualifiers. She said we cannot completely rely to some extent. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes, I do, and they're important markers. You're right. Aaron, to you, just building on this, discord granted the qualifications that Christiane mentioned, which are very important, but discord between the United States and Germany, our critical ally in Western Europe, is that not playing right into Vladimir Putin's hand?
I think there's no doubt about it. And, you know, the president came to Europe after a very successful Middle East trip from his point of view, loaded for bear. He broke a lot of crockery, Paris climate, Article 5, and the Euros are now pushing back. You know, Macron squeezing the president's hand until it almost fell off, Ms. Merkel basically making a virtue out of necessity. And I think Christiane makes an important point. There is a certain reality here. with Britain on its way out and some of Mr. Trump's campaign commitments actually coming true, I think there's an adjustment going on here. And Ms. Merkel, the leader not only of the European Union, but it looks like the free world, is getting used to the reality that there's not only a lot of uncertainty, but the American role in Europe, the transatlantic alliance, may simply not be as primary. And I think that's sad. One additional point, the president talks about making America great again, but the problem is that he is undermining the very mechanisms, the security architecture, and the nature of the alliances that allowed the United States for decades to project its power and to be a force for good and for positive change in the world.
He was not explicit at that NATO meeting of his support and the U.S. support for Article 5, the collective defense and security agreement. Colonel Francona, you tweeted about this recently. About time someone holds the Europeans and Canadians to their NATO commitments, perhaps, quote, not after 2 o'clock. We'll listen this time. Do you think the president's actions are effective, especially eliciting a response like this from Angela Merkel?
Well, as I said, it's about time we hold the Europeans accountable. We need to tell the Germans and the French they need to live up to their commitments. If this transatlantic alliance is going to work, and it has been, as Aaron said, it has been the backbone of our transatlantic relationship for decades, it's important that that alliance continue. But the United States can't foot the bill the entire time. You know, for decades, relied on this massive military might of the United States and the defense umbrella that goes with that to focus on their economies while the United States focuses on their defense. And that has got to change. There's a great path forward for the alliance, but we have to go in this as partners. And that partnership has to be addressed on a more equal footing.
You know, Christian, Poppy. Yes.
Yeah, go ahead.
Weigh in, but I also want you to answer this part of my question, which is this is the president who ran on America First, right? And that's a big part of what got him elected. However, given the world today, it is not America alone. Does this president's policies, rhetoric, et cetera, not even, you know, as you said, no joint statement out of the G7, does that put America First at risk?
Well, look, you know, it's very confusing what just happened there. I don't think there was any sort of real America First sort of conclusion there. But I think just to take exception with what Lieutenant Colonel Francona has just said, there is no treaty obligation for this 2%. I'm sorry, it's just not there. This was something that's aspirational, that came after the invasion by Vladimir Putin of eastern Ukraine, and that all the NATO countries said, yes, we need to step up the contribution to NATO. And of course, that's aspirational, and of course, it should happen. But by saying that this is a transactional relationship, it ignores the reality, which is that Europeans have been doing a lot. Yes, some of the countries are at 2%, some of them aren't. But the excessive amount of money that the United States has been paying over the last 16 years is because of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. Look at the balance sheet, look at the figures. That is why the United States has been paying way disproportionately its amount. And I will say at this point, you can imagine how it really gets in the craw of people over in Europe who invoked Article 5 for the first time in their history to support the United States after it was attacked on 9/11. Mm-hmm. So this is not a transactional relationship. And there's no such thing as back taxes by NATO members to pay into
works.
A common... It just doesn't work like that. And if you look at the figures, and I would refer you all to a very good breakdown by Peter Baker in the New York Times today of precisely what is on the plus side, what is on the negative side, and what actually matters in this relationship. Mm-hmm. The idea that President Trump and the United States might want to sort of jangle up this 70-plus year alliance that's kept the peace in Europe for this long is one that's creating quite a lot of, you know, concern over here in Europe.
Concerned, to say the least, not only the first time Article 5, the only time Article 5 was invoked for the United States after 9/11. Aaron David.